This panel is film and literature in Italy, and there will be a Q&A at the end of the both papers. First paper is by Fred MISURELLA from East Stroudsburgh University. Fred has published Lies to Live By, thank you. Stories, Short Time, a novella, and Understanding Milan Kundera, Public Events, Private Affairs, a critical study of Kundera's work. His stories and nonfiction have been in Partisan Review, Salamagundi, Kansas Quarterly, Voices in Italian Americana, L'Atelier du Roman, the Christian Science Monitor, The Village Voice, and the New York Times Book Review. His essays on Primo Levi appear in The Legacy of Primo Levi and Answering Auschwitz. He teaches writing and Italian-American literature at East Stroudsburgh University in Pennsylvania, and he is the current book review editor of VIA.
In any case, I'm doing a paper on Elena Ferrante, Internal Journeys from Childhood to Adulthood in Elena Ferrante's Neapolitan Novels. Elena Ferrante's Neapolitan trilogy, soon to be a quartet with a fourth part coming out in the United States this fall, comprises a particularly interesting combination of literary modes, the psychological novel and the political one, along with the traditional German narrative form of the Bildungsroman, a novel of education, that in the case of the Neapolitan series also functions as a Künstlerroman, a narrative about the growth and education of an artist. James Joyce's Portrait of the Artist as a Young Man is a 20th century Künstlerroman, for example, and Theodore Dreiser's Sister Carrie presents an American example of a woman's growth as an actress. There are others, of course, but Ferrante's trilogy, like Dreiser's, mixes serious sociological and psychological issues with artistic ones, in this case with two women who are best friends from girlhood to maturity and whose paths, because of luck and choices, diverge and cross dramatically, with one enjoying academic and literary success for a time in the North, while the brighter, more personally powerful of the two enters a materially successful marriage to help her family. Both find married life, at least with their chosen husbands, emotionally dissatisfying, and by the end of the third book, leave their husbands and children. One, with the materially good marriage, goes to work and chooses to cooperate with Italian socialists and communists for better working conditions, and the other, the narrator, who has published a novel with some success, leaves her family to travel with a young man she has loved since high school in Naples. There is a strong sense of soapbox melodrama on the surface of Ferrante's transparent narratives. She portrays women in extreme anguish, primarily caused by the men in their lives, yet because she concentrates on the growth and education of intelligent, artistically gifted women striving to define themselves, she dramatizes their conflicts amid the traditional behavior patterns expected of Italians generally, patterns that especially for women contradict expectations of artistic originality, individual genius, and unusual life experience. Essentially, the questions these novels raise have to do with finding and fulfilling one's soul in the rapidly changing last half of the 20th century, while the millennia-long influence of Italian traditions, women's household roles, the Catholic Church, and loyalty to family and locale weighs more heavily on human shoulders every day. Erik Erikson, the German-born psychologist who wrote about the identity crisis as a stage in ordinary human development, delivered a paper entitled Reflections on the Revolt of Humanist Youth at a symposium on higher education at Lake Como in 1968. It is collected in his 1975 book of essays, Life History and the Historical Moment. In the paper, Erickson centers on the worldwide 1960s campus revolts, especially in Europe and the United States, and outlines several psychosocial patterns that indicate a rejection of parental failures or what youth see as such, an eagerness for a new beginning that will elude those failures, and a simultaneous rejection of and resistance to the prior generation's accomplishments, especially technological ones. Since the principal characters of Ferrante's Neapolitan series were both born in 1944, it is clear that their historical moment is post-World War II, and the parental failures they reject and the prior generation's accomplishments they resist have to do with their nation's embrace of fascism and its subsequent survival after the debacle of the Mussolini years. So there is much to reject in their parents' generation and much to resist as the post-World War II economic miracle, especially in Northern Italy, rejuvenated the arts, expanded technology, and changed the nation's culture generally. In reaction to the economic expansion in America and Western Europe, 1960s youth, Erickson points out, dropped out, that is, rejected their parents' material accomplishments and goals for the future. At the same time, they tuned in to alternative ideas and behavior patterns and turned on to social political events, both bizarre and challenging, then occurring in the world around them. They sought a new direction, Erickson says, one that would give them hope of avoiding the prior generation's mistakes, especially materialism and conformity, and sought to create a world where you could do your own thing, as Ralph Waldo Emerson said, and still live comfortably, but with a closer tie to nature, which Emerson and his Concord, Massachusetts neighbor Thoreau also said. Erickson summarized his ideas about the generation this way: for youthful behavior always appears to be prophetically inspired by the vigor of a new age, and yet also retrogressive in its insistence on outworn simplicities, and at times beset with astonishing personal regressions. The vigor of a new age and personal regressions are the key terms here, because in all of Ferrante's novels, we see similar conflicts dramatized. Women live, work, and feel their lives independently, but at some point in the narratives, they realize that they need to retreat at the same time to family traditions, to a neighborhood and its dialect, or to a man. Such conflicts make for the intriguing psychological and emotional dramas Ferrante describes. When Erickson used the word youth in this essay, he referred to college adolescence, that long, variable stage of life between childhood and adulthood, where you are no longer dependent, but not really independent either. He describes that period psychologically as a stage of transition from an alternately invigorating and enslaving sense of an overdefined past, that is the world of the parents, to a future as yet to be identified and to be identified with, and that is the world of the individual self. That particular transitional stage of youth is exactly where Ferrante's principal characters in the Neapolitan novels, Lila and Elena, find themselves and their friends in the working class neighborhood they were born and have grown up in during Italy's post-World War II recovery. The alternately invigorating and enslaving past of neighbors, church, Southern Italian poverty, family roles, and Neapolitan dialect struggles with their internal sense of personal promise. Intelligent, both academically and on the street, energetic with emotional and physical desire, both Lila and Elena love books and aspire to be writers. They do extremely well in school, constantly earning top scores in their grades, yet Elena gives way to Lila, whom she judges to be brighter, courageous, and more original. thus the title of the first book in the series, My Brilliant Friend. When they are girls, Lila writes a novel called The Blue Fairy, which Elena reads and finds very powerful, so much so that she binds it into a book with covers before showing it to their teacher. But the teacher dismisses it as unimportant because Lila's family has refused to let her continue to the next grade in school. Yet for Elena, whose parents allow her to continue, the idea of writing a story and creating a book moves her so much that she makes writing her own life's goal. As the girls grow, their characters and family finances drive them in different social directions, yet their internal conflicts remain similar in that both strive for personal fulfillment. At the same time, family, neighborhood, and language hold them back. Lila's family, especially their finances, as well as her own strong sense of independence and creativity, take her off the path of formal education. Instead, she works with her father, an older brother, town shoe repairers, and in her spare time creates a pair of men's shoes that become a popular success, selling to stores and people beyond their neighborhood. With seed money from the Solaras, the family rumored to lead the local Camorra, Lila's family finally becomes solvent. And while Elena moves north to work for a degree at the university in Pisa, Lila remains home, grows very beautiful, and at 18 agrees to marry a neighborhood boy in a lavish wedding ceremony. That marriage, together with Elena's university experiences in Pisa, marked the divergent thematic paths of the novels as well as their lives, making the choices of each of the young women dramatize and clarify their interactions with each other and their Neapolitan neighborhood, as well as the particular historical moment their two lives share. Lila and Elena live in the post-World War II Italian recovery, as well as the 1960s sexual revolution. And their lives represent different reactions to that period of rejection, recovery, and finally intense social and sexual change brought on by a disavowal of a world made by Mussolini and Hitler, followed by the use of a pill that allowed women to make new choices on the way towards social and economic independence. And while the stronger personality of the two, Lila, inexplicably gives into family and neighborhood with her marriage, she still encourages the meeker Elena to fulfill her intellectual promise. Lila buys Elena school books and provides her a quiet room in her new home to study. When Elena leaves Naples for Pisa and the university as a result of Lila's help, it is her first experience away from parents and hometown, and equally important for her story, her first extended period away from her best friend. In contrast to Lila, she grows, and her social and intellectual life changes dramatically. Mocked for her dialect at first, she struggles to speak correct Italian, and by working hard, succeeds in school. But the real key to her acceptance by the academics of Pisa is her relationship with two male students, one a political radical who becomes her lover for a while, and the other the academically gifted Pietro, a northerner whom she later marries, in that way leaving the world of Naples completely behind. She writes a novel inspired by Lila's childhood story, The Blue Fairy, and succeeds in publishing it with the help of Pietro's mother, who works as an editor in a prominent publishing house. The novel is a great success. She begins writing opinion pieces for Italy's leftist papers and is taken up by the liberal intellectual world of Turin, Pisa, and other northern cities. And of course, when she marries Pietro, a dedicated scholar and teacher of classical literature, they settle in the north near his university. Clearly, Elena has now made the break from her past and moved up to a different social plane from Lila. Yet true to Erickson's description of 1960s youth, Elena's friend, family, and neighborhood have continued to draw her back. Before her marriage, when she spends a summer caring for Lila's child and mother at the sea, she once again meets and falls in love with Nino, the boy she idolized in her youth, a boy who was an excellent student and, like her, attends a university in the North. Their conversations about politics and current events move Elena to contrast those talks with the language and subject matter of Neapolitan vacationers they hear around them. One night, Lila's mother, Nunzia, voices the central social and linguistic premise of the novels. "How well you speak, Lenu," Elena's childhood nickname. "It's clear that you'll have a wonderful future." Tears came to her eyes. She murmured that Lila should have gone to school. It was her destiny. Instead, she got married. She chose a different path. And one can't go back. Life takes us where it wants. And yet, according to Erickson's and Ferrante's story, life and the human psyche don't offer a one-way itinerary. Instead, they move us back and forth, sometimes to new places, like the north of Italy or America, sometimes to times and locations we've lived in before. To arrive at San Giovanni, Elena writes upon traveling to Naples to commiserate with Lila after the latter leaves her husband, "I had forcibly to regress, as if Lila had gone to live not in a street or a square, but a ripple of time past. Before we went to school, a black time, without rules and without respect. I resorted to the most violent dialect of the neighborhood. I insulted, I was insulted, I threatened. I was mocked. I responded by mocking, a spiteful art in which I was trained. Naples had been very useful in Pisa, but Pisa was no use in Naples. It was an obstacle." Following Erickson's model, we can understand why both these women, having moved forward into a location outside their Naples neighborhood, could not leave it emotionally. Perhaps I should say that it could not, or would not, leave them. Like many Italians who left the South and journeyed to America, they find themselves back where they started, poverty-stricken, victimized by mafia and Camorra henchmen, and disdained by open personal and social bias, even as they have shown courage and initiative in making a new start in a country and language they know little about. The critic James Wood, in writing about an earlier Ferrante novel, The Lost Daughter, quotes Lita, the novel's main character, who is about to abandon her daughters for 3 years because motherhood has taken over her life. And here's the quote, "I seem to be falling backward toward my mother or grandmother, the chain of mute or angry women I came from." Lita fears that loving the children too much has prevented her from becoming herself. Her children, she adds, "I felt about her children," she adds, "I felt their gazes longing to tame me, but more brilliant was the brightness of the life outside them. New colors, new bodies, new intelligence, a language to possess finally as if it were my true language." The final chapters of the third of the Neapolitan novels, Those Who Leave and Those Who Stay, serve to highlight the role language plays in the crises of identity the two women struggle with. On a return to Naples to attend a party in honor of her sister's engagement, Elena says, "I realized that my voice was taking on the tones of the dialect out of nervousness, that words were coming to me in the Neapolitan of the neighborhood, that the neighborhood from the courtyard to the stradone and the tunnel was imposing its language on me. Its mode of acting and reacting, its figures, those which in Florence seemed faded images and here were flesh and blood." And after her marriage, when she begins an affair with Nino, her secret childhood love, she makes another comment on the importance of language to the self. "Words allowed us to fantasize, constructing glorious prospects, but also imposing on us an order, containing us, frightening us, finding ourselves together in the tiny space of the car, careless of the terrible heat, gave concreteness to our delirium, gave it the cloak of inevitability, made it consistent with the forms of realism of that era, those which asked for the impossible. James Wood makes much of the fact that Ferrante's writing dramatizes the theory of the French feminist critic Hélène Cixous, whose essay The Laugh of the Medusa is a landmark of feminist literary theory. Woman must write herself, Cixous wrote in 1975, in order to take back the literary language which has been male, she argued, that has subjected women throughout history. Ferrante has more inclusive ideas, I think. When Elena's husband, Pietro, finds out that she plans to leave him for Nino, his agonized reaction brings on this comment from Elena. Maybe in the face of abandonment, we are all the same. Maybe not even a very orderly mind like Pietro's can endure the discovery of not being loved. Language can confine as well as liberate, and we must learn to master it in order to flourish as individuals and as a group. The passage from The Lost Daughter relates to more than its main character. It embodies the entire Italian self, male and female, young, and in Ferrante's words, both those who leave and those who stay. With particular application to the Mezzogiorno, it expresses a yearning to escape local familial and social limitations in order to participate in the larger world, to become a participant in human history generally, as well as the specific present moment in time.
Our next and actually final speaker is Marianne McDonald Carolan, who is an associate professor of modern languages and literatures and director of the Italian Studies Program at Fairfield University. She's the author of The Transatlantic Gaze, Italian Cinema, American Film, which was published by State University of New York Press 2014. The book documents the sustained and profound artistic impact of Italian cinema upon filmmakers in the United States from the post-war period to the new millennium. Her current book-length project, Orienting Italy, China Through the Lens of Italian Filmmakers, examines the ways in which Italian directors have employed documentary, historical fiction, and fictional narratives to represent China and its people both at home and abroad in Italy. Her paper today is titled Chinese Youth in Contemporary Italian Cinema.
First, an apology because the clips I'm going to show you are in Italian, so they're translations from the Chinese, so I'll help you with that. I can't help you with the Chinese, though. And thank you all for what's been a really interesting and fascinating discussion today. As you heard from Peter, this is part of a much larger project and my talk today, and I'm really happy for any input that any of you would like to offer. It's very much a work in process. So the late 20th century and the early 21st centuries have witnessed a reversal of the flow of the trade that spurred Italians, led by Marco Polo, to venture to China centuries ago. And over the past decade, thousands of Chinese have immigrated to Italy on account of the entrepreneurial possibilities that that country offers. The success of these immigrants has created, in turn, tensions with Italians who feel that traditional ways of manufacturing and consequently their own livelihoods have been threatened. A recent documentary entitled Miss Little China from 2009 by sociologists Cremona and De Cecco investigates Chinese youth and intergenerational differences in contemporary Italy. The directors allow Italians to reveal their prejudices, fears, and ignorance about Chinese culture against the backdrop of the beauty pageant of the title. And here's just a clip from, a shot of the ending of Miss Little China. Stephen Lau, the Chinese-Italian entrepreneur who exports Italian shoes to Beijing and Canton, founded this competition in 2004 in Milan. And his goal was to show that the Chinese are gente normale, with all the virtues and vices that everyone else has. And like his work in the marketplace, this contest bridges the two cultures for the Chinese, when the whom the Italians associate with laboratori clandestini, mafia, lavoro nero, so clandestine workshops, mafia, and black market. Miss China in Italy is a new approach to integration through the use of social politics focused on inclusion. It seems to have worked, while the jury is made up, still to this day, entirely of Chinese entrepreneurs. The audience, as of 2013, was one-third Italian. The beauty pageant of the title, really, it's Miss China in Italy, reminds the viewer of the possibilities for fame and earnings that arise from such contests. Bellissima, Roberto Rossellini's 1951 story, illustrates the compromises that a stage mother, played here by Anna Magnani, makes in an attempt to have her rather plain daughter realize the title of the film. In Little Miss China, this competition takes place in the Casino of Venice, but since 2012 it has moved to the province of Como. But just a note on why did it take place in Venice? Well, Stephen Lau felt that it was the perfect place considering the long history that began of the exchange between Italy and China that began with Marco Polo. So contestants represent a cross-section of young Chinese women in Italy, although for the most part they come from the central north and from cities such as Prato and Brescia. Some were born in Italy, others have recently arrived, and they all strive for a better life and perhaps the chance at celebrity. After all, why could they not become the next Sophia Loren, who was discovered at age 14 at a beauty contest? Of course, this is not always necessarily the case for ethnic others, as director Fred Cuorno points out in his new documentary entitled Blacks Blow Italian, Cent'anni di Afrostorie nel Cinema Italiano. And in this documentary, which is based on the book L'Africa in Italia, Africa in Italy, which is edited by Leonardo De Franceschi, Cuorno calls for diversity on screen, and here I quote him. In the past few years, Italian cinema has not reflected the demographic shift in Italian society. Young Italian actors of Black, Asian, or Latin background must play the stereotypical roles of delinquent, marginalized folks, and refugees, even though Italian cinema, and especially that of the Neorealist period, portrayed stories in which Africans played important roles. Cuorno's documentary chronicles the career of several Afro-Italian or African or other ethnic groups on screen, but one in particular is pertinent to this talk today, and that is the story of Denny Mendez, who, after being a runner-up in her native Santo Domingo, came to Italy, where she won the beauty pageant of Miss Italy, or Miss Italia, in 1996. That was the contest took place in the town of Salso Maggiore, and it caused a great stir throughout the nation. Mendez was the first woman of non-Italian ancestry to be elected to represent Italy in an international beauty pageant. Some Italians saw this as a clarion call to close their borders to further immigration. Two judges were suspended for declaring that a Black woman could not represent Italian beauty. And the news of the first Black Miss Italy was carried to millions overseas via the popular African-American periodical called Jet Magazine. And here I quote, 9 million Italians voted to shatter the prism of race just by watching a TV beauty pageant and phoning in their votes. Beauty is, indeed, in the eyes of the beholder, and the eyes of the world today are quite capable of seeing past skin color. End quote. Yet the tensions between the Italians and the Chinese is a topic that touches on economic competition, racism, and cultural difference. Think, for example, of Eduardo Nesi's La Storia della Mia Gente, The Story of My People from 2010, which captures in a very personal way the demise of traditional clothing manufacturing in Tuscany with the advent of globalization and the decline in quality, according to him, of the Made in Italy label. But for this paper, I wish to concentrate on the portrayal of the Chinese-Italian youth. ISTAT, the Italian National Institute for Statistics, their polls from 2013-2014 report that of the 3.875 million non-European member residents, or extracomunitari, in Italy, that the third most after Moroccans and Albanians, and the total number is 300, or official number then was 320,000 Chinese, of which 24% are minors. There are very few people over the age of 65, Chinese over the age of 65, which we see in this documentary leads certain Italians to say that they never die, because they don't see them die, because they're all so very young. So Chinese illegal immigration occurs mainly by air and not by the perilous sea route that we have seen so much about lately. Most illegal Chinese immigrants arrive in Italy with valid tourist visas and then remain clandestinely. Chinese migration to Italy differs from that of the Moroccans and the Albanians in that most come with their families, according to a 2010 survey conducted in Torino. In this way, the Chinese in Italy have adopted patterns more similar to those of the Northern Europeans who came to the United States in the late 19th and early 20th centuries, and differs from those of the Italian immigrants whom we know were for the most part men who came, even if they had families, alone and were aged between 15 and 40 years old. Chinese immigrant communities are not integrated, as the sociologist Massimo Introvigne, the director of CENSUR, which is the Centro Studi sulle Nuove Religioni, reports in an article in Immigrazione Oggi, Immigration Today. The Chinese in Turin, for example, feel much closer to China than they do to Italy. They read Chinese newspapers, they watch Chinese television, and they know only a few Italian people. Yet despite this lack of social integration, according to Introvigne, Chinese children are very well assimilated into the Italian educational system, where they prove to be well-prepared, studious, and ben educati. The CESNUR study found that, although many Chinese immigrants had difficulty learning Italian, their children had overcome linguistic obstacles and achieved fluency in Italian. And one of the things I want to talk to you about today is the intergenerational conflicts that I'm so happy that I think that our two talks may have some overlap here. So Vincenzo De Cecco and Riccardo Cremona believe in the power of the documentary, which is seldom studied and little appreciated in Italy. So with this film, they wished, and they'd made several other documentaries before this, they wished to make Miss Little China as a way, they conceived of Miss Little China as a way to address the stereotypes that surround the Chinese community living in Italy. De Cecco and Cremona wanted to dispel certain popular cliches, such as the idea that Chinese never die, that they serve cats and rats in the restaurants, and that they engage in the practice of slavery. Well, this point, it may be up for some debate when we consider what happened in December of 2013 when seven workers died in a fire and they'd been locked into their sweatshop. But that's for another paper. With this documentary, the filmmakers sought to upend the idea that the Chinese were an invading force seeking to conquer the world, Italy first. The directors sought to, quote, get to know one Chinese person, then another, and then yet another, to finally hear what they have to say about us, end quote. This film, which won the Concorso Doc Italiano dell'Otto Edizione del Tecnifest for the best documentary, was, according to a review in Cinema Italiano, had succeeded in presenting the topical issue of immigration in clearly and in refreshingly original manner. The review compliments the directors for weaving many different voices and media to express perspectives on current realities in Italy from both sides of the equation. And here I want to play the opening sequence.
Uno, due, tre!
Ragazze, grinta, mi raccomando, svegli e attente che ce la facciamo. Ce la dobbiamo
fare.
Dai.
Però,
scusa.
Però lei dopo va dentro. Scusa, fuori turno.
sta per iniziare Miss China in Italy. Seguiremo tutto l'evento, anzi seguiranno con l'occhio delle telecamere tutto l'evento. Si parte, le ragazze sono splendide come mai, l'atmosfera è giusta e Venezia è la location ideale. Andiamo!
算了，不要弄了，不要了，开玩笑的解散了，啊，不要开。好，同学们，今天呢，我们跟大家讲一讲，就是意大利。上次我们讲过的，很多同学在意大利，但是不知道意大利是什么回事情。这个它的地理情况，从它的这个政治情况、历史情况向大家介绍一下。首先，我们知道意大利在世界的东半球还是西半球啊？西半球，所以意大利是个西方的国家。
Io, come ho detto, ho visto TG dossier sui cinesi, sparsi per tutta Italia. Sono andati a Prato, mi meraviglio che nessun cittadino di Prato vi chiami. L'igiene, non vi dico cosa ho visto, orribilante. Hanno detto che Prato è la città d'Italia più inquinata di tubercolosi, perché i cinesi sputtano per terra.
An idea of the voices that are overlaid of Italians commenting on the Chinese. But it's important to note that the documentarians did not set out to tell the story of this particular beauty pageant, but they felt that it was the perfect vehicle for them to penetrate what was considered a rather insular community, the Chinese community, and to allow the individuals to speak for themselves and not to do some kind of abstract sociological examination from the outside. And what they found, they were actually rather surprised at the honesty with which people, the mothers and daughters for the most part, we don't see any fathers, it's just the relationship between the mothers and the daughters. And they were surprised at the honesty of expression, especially from those mothers who had left their children behind in China when they came to Italy to make enough money to then be able to send for them. And this, if those of you in the audience might have seen a beautiful, I mean actually lyrical film by Andrea Segre called Io Sono Lì, Shun Li and the Poet, which tells a similar story in that Shun Li is a young woman who has come to Italy to work, but she must work, as she says, she works and she waits, and she works and she pays, and then she waits for the arrival of her 8-year-old son. I would highly recommend that. I mean, and that little boy is going to be part of the topic of our conversation today in Italian youth. So they were struck at the consistent response as well by Chinese young people who were determined not to live like their parents, who had sacrificed so much for their families to survive in Italy. Indeed, their assimilation into Italian society meant that they embraced the values of Italian youth, including expectations for vacation and regular time off from work. Honestly, if you can tell me what's going on in the background with the man with the cross, I don't know if this is a passion play or something.
Mi sento italiana nel dire che non voglio lavorare sempre, voglio avere le ferie. Io ho visto troppi amici che lavorano 7 giorni su 7, gente giovane che apre la propria attività e lavora sempre. A Milano ho degli amici che lavorano dal lunedì alla domenica, tutti i giorni dalle 8 alle 8. Sono rimasta sconvolta. Io ho detto a mio padre, non voglio lavorare tutti i giorni, come fanno loro. Anche loro lavorano sempre. Quando abbiamo lavoro qua nel laboratorio, loro lavorano dalla mattina alla sera, sempre. Tutti i giorni. Poi si sta a casa quando non c'è lavoro, però se c'è da lavorare lavorano sempre. Io mi rifiuto e ho detto a mio padre che organizzerò la mia vita in modo da avere le mie vacanze d'estate, le mie vacanze d'inverno, il mio giorno libero alla settimana, magari due. Questo vorrei.
let's take a look at the parents' perspective. And this is the professor, begins with the professor, and then we hear a mother interviewed. This is the professor with whom, whose lessons began.
我们这一代人了，我们主要是通过工作来度过我们的生活。但是这个二十年来呢，由于第二代从中国来的或者在这里生活成长的，因为有些青年人呢，我认为这个表现不是很好。是啊，你们我阿姨呢，我是找是学最大的才能。如果给你在街市上不包啊，不过给个那个是西式学，怎么给你那个当了个怎么给给个中国要我你的一般人的给给了把给那个富有还比个自然呢。
And we notice that at the there's still some hope with the parents. Now, Stephen Liu declares that the advantage of this so-called seconda generazione is that they, with their Western, their newfound Western values, also retain those values of home with parents who do not speak Italian. And they find themselves, as they find themselves caught between these two cultures, this causes them to accept at a very young age a certain responsibility and to become entrepreneurs themselves. By the way, Stephen Liu started the Miss China in Italy contest when he was 21 years old, and he'd already started running a factory at that time. That's why he had enough money to set this up. And I wanted to give you another sense of how parents and children look at the future.
Spero mia figlia che si trovi un lavoro quando è grande, finita di studiare, spero continua, che trovi un lavoro dignitoso, non come faccio me, 15 ore di lavoro, e non ho voglia che lei apra un ristorante o un apre bar.
Fra 10 anni sarò vecchia. Boh.
我出来的那个路费我还没有付清，我必须得自己赚钱把那个路费给付清。我们一定要努力，让自己的爸爸妈妈不要在晚年过得太辛苦了，让他们在晚年能够度过一个快乐的日子。反正他有一个工作，他自己喜欢的，不管是中国的还是老外的。
And that the mother who spoke last was the one who became very emotional when describing the fact that she had to leave her daughter at home with her daughter's father because she just couldn't afford to bring her to Italy, and how happy she was when her daughter came here. So you see the contrasting, you know, fra 10 anni, in 10 years, what will I be? This young woman says, I'll be old, you know, as if she doesn't have any ideas, we know. So in conclusion, what I'd like to leave you with is the last scene of this documentary, where we return to the Professor Liu from the beginning, who underscores the fact that Italy, that was once a country of emigration, has become a country of immigration. And as we know in this documentary, that the authors of the documentary tell us that they were looking for the secret of youth. And what they meant by that in the Chinese is they meant that their optimistic spirit, that you could achieve anything by working hard. If you worked hard enough, you could achieve it. And so he leaves us all with a question, with us all, with a question about the future for Chinese youth in Italy and Italian youth as well.
意大利跟中国人一样，是一个移民非常大的国家。那我们中国人在外国都住在一起，叫China Town，中国城，对不对？意大利人住在一起，叫Little Italy，就是小的意大利。他们也喜欢住在一起的。所以意大利人移民，一个在欧洲，一个在澳大利亚，一个在南美洲，到处都是意大利人。
为什么？因为他们的国家本来是出去的，现在有人进来，他们一下子也适应不了，到底怎么办？
Thank you.
But I'm wondering if that equivalence even worked for the youth in Italy, because I may be wrong, but it seems to me that just as you mentioned, that the youth movement in the U.S. was informed by Emerson and Thoreau's ideology. In Italy, I believe it was much more by Marx and Marx and Gramsci. And so, you know, the youth in the U.S. turned to hedonism and hyper-individuality, but the youth in Italy and Europe throughout really turned to political commitment. So I'm wondering your thoughts on this.
We were marching on Washington for civil rights. We were marching against the war in Vietnam. We were being very political. We wanted all kinds of avant-garde kind of music and this sort of stuff. But at the same time, everybody was talking about going back to the land, being natural. If you remember Woodstock, everybody rolling around in the mud with no clothes on and everything. I mean, that was a kind of retrogressive behavior, childish behavior, which at the same time was very radical and very revolutionary. And I think that's what Erickson was describing, and I think the characters in Ferrante's novels have similar kinds of stuff going on. And so that's why I feel like it's justifiable to equate them.
So in the back there? Right there?
Oh, so this is also regarding Erickson, but so it seems to me that there was a big sort of, you could call it a correction or an addition to Erickson, which is all the Carol Gilligan work that added a women's view on Erickson's stages of development and really emphasized intimacy versus isolation for women, that that's a much longer stage, it's much more important. Now some may say that's being essentialist, but I think she had a lot of research and a lot of good work to back it up. So to me, in your discussion of these books, it seems like no matter what, relationship and intimacy get really short shrift in how you and maybe the author talks about it. It seems like they're almost relegated to a very unimportant stance, and I wonder if you could comment on that sort of a more relational view of women's development and whether that could be taken into consideration with these books.
Well, obviously they can be taken into consideration, but I think the sense that I get from reading Ferrante's fiction is that her characters feel very isolated. Days of Abandonment, which many people consider to be her best novel, I don't agree with that, but many people think of it as her best novel. It's all about being left alone and about abandoned by her husband because he finds himself a younger woman, and she essentially goes, not crazy, but she becomes very strange. And what she does, she sort of goes after a kind of passive musician who lives downstairs from her, all kinds of stuff like that. There's no sense of her looking for intimacy. It's a sense of her looking for a social norm, a social position that has abandoned her and when her husband left her. And so intimacy isn't one of her strong points, that's what I would say. Now, you could criticize her on that point. You know, there are all kinds of arguments about who Ferrante is, you know. Who's Shakespeare? Who's Homer? I always say, as a response to that, we don't know. We have the texts, which I think is better than worrying about the author. And some people think a man is actually, the writer for them. We just don't know. But certainly the question of intimacy is something that you could use as a hammer to chip away, you know, at her work.
I'd like to ask you, Fred, perhaps it's related to intimacy, but certainly these two young women and the two characters represent two different ways of life. But when we talk about, you talked about Lenu a lot and her academic achievements and her life, but Leela, the character of Leela, one can, I at least immediately thought, well, she's just filled with anger and resentment because her parents denied her the opportunity to fulfill herself intellectually and socially. But her character continues to be angry, resentful, mean. Can you tell me about that?
Yeah, some people are like that, you know? I mean, from the very beginning my brilliant friend, she is an angry young girl. We don't really know why, you know? There are just some people, and I think the idea, well, the idea that I read it with is, it's her genius, looking for an outlet, looking for a way to kind of be in the world of ordinary people, especially the ordinary people of her neighborhood. And then also, of course, as she grows older, just looking for a way through the limitations that are placed upon her by her nation and her background and her culture and that sort of thing.
But her friendship with Lenu was a loving friendship, and yet she lashed out.
I've known people like this, but I'll be damned if I know why. They're just like that.
What do you think about the fact that this Chinese entrepreneur thought of a beauty pageant as a way to make his people more acceptable to Italian public opinion, in a country in which to this day women are very often objectified, and especially during the time of Berlusconi, this problem has become even more prominent than it was before.
So before I read what Stephen Lau said about this, and he's very smooth, I thought, oh, this is an attempt, this is your typical attempt to impose a Western aesthetic on an Eastern culture. He says, and he really never gets in between his, he never trips himself up in terms of his business opportunities. He said that this allowed the Italians to see the Chinese in their day-to-day life. He said in, un aspetto quotidiano. I don't know how many people sign up for a beauty pageant in their daylight lives. It hasn't happened to me really lately. and then he said that it was a way of reaching out to the Italian community. And he was particularly proud of the fact that this competition draws Italians as well as the Chinese, because initially it was sponsored by the Chinese. And even at the time that the documentary took place, most of the audience was Chinese. So in a scant 4 years, he's encouraged this Italian population to take part. He says it's a way of countering the notion that the Chinese are insular, they're closed in their own laboratorio, and we don't know anything about them. And if we don't know anything about them, then we fear them. This is a way of bringing them out, on the stage, so to speak. But I think he's being very coy in that answer.
I wonder whether the issue has to do with the fact that Italians are terrified by the idea of a culture that is so focused on work at a time, especially in which this issue is so debated and continues to be the distinction between certain countries that have invested on productivity versus countries that, of course, still defend another lifestyle, where obviously beauty, pleasure is still considered central. And I find it interesting that some of the young people are actually embracing that to identify with a new generation different from their parents. So mine is more of a comment, and I really like the fact that the documentary, I don't know if you can say something more about this, shows variety, because the biggest challenge is always to basically make a community uniform, right? And that has never been the case and will never be the case. And so it's obviously the typical mechanism behind stereotypes. But I think documentaries and works such as Andrea Segre's beautiful film actually do that, break them by showing different perspectives.
And I agree, and the documentarian said, as I mentioned in my paper, they did not set out to tell the story of this beauty pageant. They set out to tell the story of the Chinese immigrant communities. Whereas it's a diverse perspectives are revealed in this, it's mostly from the north and the central north, because you don't see too many young women. You don't see, well, the communities of the of southern Italy are not represented in this competition for the most part. I mean, that may change. De Cecco and Cremona said that they wanted to celebrate this issue of working hard and you can get anywhere, and the optimism of the Chinese and their belief in the future, and wanted to show the Italians that that's not something to be feared. Perhaps it's something to be emulated, but.
You mentioned Cornu, and so I thought of his documentary, Diciotto Io Soli, and you mentioned the Italian voices that you hear in this documentary, and I was wondering what other kind of Italian voices you hear. For example, in Cornu's documentary, you hear these Italians who are supportive of the second generation, and I was wondering if you hear any kind of similar Italian voices in that sense in this documentary.
You really only hear voiceover and you don't see Italian. I mean, Stephen Lau is interviewed and you see him in his milieu with other Italian businessmen, but you really, I guess in that way, it's not a fair representation. The documentary is a response to the idea that the Chinese, you know, don't die. Where are they? You know, we don't see any bodies in our cemeteries. And then you have the professor who visits a young man's grave and talks about how long it took to have him. He was cremated, and whether or not he was going to be expatriate, his corpse would be expatriate. I mean, a whole long conversation about that. So you really don't, you hear the kind of fears and prejudices of the Italians. Except for those who are running the pageant, and the director, photography, the master of ceremony.